Good evening, friends. This is about plus two exams, matriculation state board. I am going to explain the theory questions asked in this June 2013 onwards. We'll go from that to backwards. Now, the part A is what I am going to explain in this session. I am planning to do about 150 questions so that you'll get a clear picture. First question is the closing stock June 2013, part A, 30 questions. The first question is, the closing stock is valued at cost price or dash, whichever is lower. So you know that the stock, whether it is opening stock or closing stock, will be valued at cost or market price. Cost or market price, whichever is less. The closing stock of one period becomes the opening stock of the next period. Now that is the answer, but I would like to give you an idea why it is so. What is the principle behind showing the closing stock at cost or market price? The principle is based on accountancy, is based on the principle of conservatism. Conservatism means provide for all anticipated losses. Anticipated means likely to come, and take into consideration profit only when it is realized. For example, the closing stock, I am having 1000 kgs of gold. Let's say 1000 grams of gold with me. Today the value of the gold is, I purchased at 23,000. So 23,000 into 1000 will be my value. That is the cost. Suppose, as on the today's date of value, I purchased about 6 months back. Suppose today the value is 25,000 per gram. So the question is whether you value at 23 or 25. We should always value at 23,000 being the cost to us, not at 25,000, because before you sell it, you have not sold the goods. You may sell it later. By then the goods value may fall. So therefore, you would like to take only 23,000, being less than market price. That is, profit will be taken only when you sell the goods and you get a right to receive that 25,000. So suppose, for example, the gold price has fallen from 23,000 to 21,000. Then you have not sold, but as on that date, there is a loss. Even though you have not sold, the prudency requires that you take it at 21,000. That is the principle behind this. In other words, the stock is always valued at cost or market price, whichever is lower. The principle behind this is, accountancy is based on the principle of conservatism. Are you clear?
Prepaid expenses are shown on the dash side of the balance sheet.
So now, the second question asked is prepaid expenses. Prepaid expenses means the expenses paid in advance. So it is shown always in the asset side. What is an asset? An asset is one which can be converted into cash. I'll give an example. Suppose insurance you are paying for 2 years. Your accounting year starts from 1st April. On that date, you have paid 20,000 as insurance for 2013 and 2014. So, during that year, you are going to show 10,000 as expense. The balance 10,000, you will be showing as an expenditure of the next year. That is called prepaid. The expenditure of next year paid in advance is called as prepaid expenditure. Therefore, it will be shown in the asset side of the balance sheet. The journal entry is the insurance account data 10,000. I am just giving an example. And then prepaid insurance paid in advance account data 10,000 to bank. So therefore, debit the expense, that will go to P&L account. debit the asset, that will go to the balance sheet. Right. Next question.
Interest on capital is debited in dash account.
Dear friends, as per the Partnership Act, the partners are not entitled to any interest unless there is a provision in the agreement, then only interest will be payable. Interest on loans given by partners will be eligible at the rate of 6% unless there is an agreement between the partners. This is the position of Partnership Act. Now, actually, what happens is profit and loss account, profit and loss appropriation account. There are two accounts will be there in the profit and loss account. Profit and loss account will be helpful to ascertain whether you have made profit or loss for a given period. That is sales less expenditure. Then out of that profits, partners will make some arrangement. They may take interest on capital, they may take some salary for working or discount, commission on sales, etc. This will normally come in what's called as appropriation account. Profit and loss appropriation account is the basis. But you can take it as profit and loss account, but more importantly, profit and loss appropriation will be the better word. Right. So the answer given is profit and loss account, but better answer will be profit and loss appropriation account. Next.
In dash system, only personal and cash accounts are open.
See, we have two types of systems. The question is, in dash system, only personal and what is next one?
Cash accounts are open.
Cash account. So we have two types of systems. The first system is traditionally we were following single entry system. In a single entry system, the profit is ascertained by finding out the difference in the capital. So therefore, in a double entry system, the profit is ascertained by taking nominal accounts. A nominal means expense and income accounts. But in a single entry system, you will have to calculate the closing capital, that is assets minus liabilities. Similarly, opening capital. So the difference will be the change in the capital. So the change in the capital, for this you have to add drawings and less additions. This therefore we have to say it is a single entry system. Next.
Credit purchase can be ascertained as the balancing figure in the dash.
See, credit purchases, that is when you are selling, purchasing goods on credit, you will have to open debtor creditors account. Purchase is a debit account. Purchases account debtor to total creditors. So therefore, by opening the total creditors account, we will be able to find out what is the credit purchases. Cash purchases will come in the cash book. So all credit entries will come in the total creditors account. What are the items in total creditors account? Two opening balance will be there, two purchases, by opening balance, and this is the total creditors account. So therefore you have by opening balance, by purchases, that is creditors, then purchases, two returns, then the other adjustments will be there. So in other words, if you open total creditors account, you can get credit purchases. Next.
The estimated sale value of the asset at the end of its economic life is called as dash value.
See friends, whenever you buy a machine or any other assets which are depreciable assets, the assets which depreciate are buildings, furniture and machinery. These are the three assets which will depreciate. Land will not depreciate. So what normally you do is calculation of depreciation. Suppose I buy a machinery. The machinery is valued at 1,05,000. I estimate that the value, you can use the asset for 10 years. Economic life. Economic life is different from actual life. After that 10 years, the asset becomes useless. You cannot use it for the business because you have too many repairs, etc. So, I have purchased an asset, say for example 1,05,000. I am estimating the life is for 10 years, at the end of which the value is only can 5000. That is estimated realizable value at the end of its economic life. So I call it as scrap value. So the answer is scrap value. So depreciation I am going to charge 1,05,000 minus 5000 divided by 10 years. That is a normal method of charging depreciation. So that is the answer is scrap value. Right. Next question.
Dash method of depreciation is used in the case of lease.
You know, you all know, under leasing of assets, we use annuity method. What is this lease? As you know, I have taken a house for lease. Annual rent is 10,000. So I have paid 40,000 rupees for 4 years. So here, if it is normally, you know, you pay every year 10,000, but you have paid 40,000 first year itself. So only at the end of the first year, 10,000 will get expired. You have used. So still 30,000 will be there. Next year 10,000. Like that the value comes down. So what they will do is, suppose had I keep every year I have to pay 10,000 only, then I have 30,000 I could have deposited in a bank deposit. I would have got 5% interest, 6% interest. So what you do is, in this lease method, this 40,000 that you are paying now will be multiplied with the lease. Lease method, what happens is, say for example, normally if there is no interest accrued, 1 rupee you have paid now itself, which will be written off 4 years. 1 rupee in 4 years means per year 25%. But in lease method, you recognize that amount would fetch some interest. Suppose you take an interest of 5%, you may have to write off as per annuity table 28%. In other words, to write off 1 rupee at the rate of 5%, over a period of 4 years, you have to write off only 28% instead of 24.5%. So therefore, that the extra money is the interest credited. This is called as annuity method. So what you do, the 40,000 into 0.282, you will get the amount to be written off as lease. So every year on outstanding balance, you will get credit 5% and then write it off. At the end of the fourth year, you will have a zero balance. In other words, all leases where you are paying the 4 years amount now, 1 year rent is 10,000, 4 years rent is 40,000, but that 40,000 you pay now. So therefore you recognize that money could have fetched you some interest. Therefore annuity method will be found out. Annuity tables they will give you in the exam. Therefore whatever 40,000 into annuity factor. So the point as you understand is to write off 1 rupee over a 4 year period to 25 paise per year. But here you will use 2.282 because of the accrued interest of 5%. Right. So it's the lease method, annuity method for leases. Next.
Ratio helps in dash forecasting.
Dash
forecasting.
Financial forecasting. What is it? Financial forecasting, huh? So it is the ratios will help in analyzing the balance sheets, analyzing the financial position of the company. So ratio is a method by which you will analyze the financial position of the company. That is the basis of ratios. For example, if you go to a doctor because you are having a fever, doctor would like to, fever is only a symptom, but the reason why you are getting fever, the doctor has to check up. So obviously he will ask you to blood test and things like that. So it can be a normal fever, it can be a cancer also. Similarly, you are a doctor for a company. When you are going to analyze the financial health of the company, you will use ratios. For example, ratio means it's a 1 by 2 is a ratio, A by B is a ratio. But to be useful, you may say what is the sales, 10 lakhs. What is the gross profit, 2 lakhs. So 20% of the sales is the gross profit. That means 80% of the sales is the cost of production. So, suppose if other companies are having gross profit of 30%, then you would like to know why you are having 20%. So in other words, ratios are basically symptoms which will help you in analyzing the financial performance. But in this case, they have given financial forecasting as the answer. Forecasting means projecting the future based on the data given. So you can take that as a financial forecasting. Right. I am going by the answers given, but my emphasis is to explain you what is that subject, why you have that answer. That is the reason. Next.
When total sales is rupees 2 lakhs, cash sales is rupees 65,000, then credit sales will be.
So we all know this is a simple question. Total sales is equal to cash sales plus credit sales. Total sales is equal to cash sales plus credit sales. So if cash sales is given, balance will be credit sales. So it is 1,35,000. 2 lakhs minus 65,000. Correct? 2 lakhs minus 65,000. Right. Next.
Cash budget is also called as.
Cash budget. What is a budget? Budget is talking about future. Cash budget is nothing but projected receipts and payments account. What is the cash inflow you are expecting from various sources? It could be opening balance of cash, the collections for cash sales, collections from debtors. Then you may sell some assets if you have planned to sell, receipts from the sale of assets, interest, dividend and other incomes which you are expecting to receive. Beforehand you are planning what should be the future, because cash is the most important part of the business. If you want to achieve all your plans, you need to have cash. So on 1st January, you will project for the 12 month period what will be the likely receipts, what will be the likely payments. So by this you will know whether you are going to have shortfall in 1 month and then more money in another month. So suppose, for example, I find my projection shows June I will be short of let us say 10 lakhs. Now itself I plan for arranging this through bank overdraft, or I may postpone payments and increase the speed of the collections, etc. So cash budget is basically a projected future receipts and payments account. This is also called as financial budgets. Cash budget is a short term, less than 1 year. Remember, cash flow is a long term, more than 1 year. Cash budget is prepared for 1 day, 1 week, 15 days, 1 month, fortnightly, 1 year, up to 1 year. That's all. Next.
Mutual and dash agency is the essential essence of partnership.
Now, the essence of partnership, section 4 of Partnership Act, if you go through, partnership is an agreement between two or more persons. One. For what? Why are you entering an agreement? To carry on a business. Business is always represented by profit motive. And the most important thing is the business is carried on by all the partners, or any one of them acting for all. That is the essence of, that is called as mutual agency. If you read the definition of the partnership section 4, it clearly tells you the basic ingredients of a partnership is any person can join together to share profit. They may not be partners. People can do business, but they may not have an understanding of be a partner. So I appoint somebody to do the business for me and I agree to pay him 20% of the profits. He may be an employee. So I take 10 lakhs from somebody as a loan. I agree to pay 20% share in the profits. He is not a partner. But partnership is essentially a relationship between two or more persons, where the concept of mutual agency, that means all partners can do the business, or on behalf of all partners, anyone can do the business. That is, I'll give another example. Suppose A, B, C, D are partners. they are, let us say, doing a stationary business. So A is going and purchasing the goods on credit from a company, and then the goods are brought to, and then they sell it in their shop. One day A goes there, purchases the stationery, but uses it for himself. But the liability created by A must be borne by B, C, D. That is the concept. So long as the partners are doing the transaction in the ordinary course of the business, then their acts will bind others. In other words, A buying goods on credit will bind B, C, D. That is called as mutual agency. The partnership business is driven by the principle of principle and agents, law of agency. So therefore, the concept, what he rightly says, is implied agency, mutual agency or implied agency. Next.
Goodwill is a dash asset.
Now friends, there are two types of assets. One characteristic, all assets are debit balances. Another characteristic is any asset which can be converted into cash is called an asset. Asset's nature is, when you want to eliminate them, you will get cash. You take debt of 1 lakh, it's become 50,000. Why? Normally because money 50,000 has come. Similarly, you have machinery. If you want to sell the machinery, you will get money. So the nature of the asset is one which can be converted into cash. Now, assets are of two types. Tangible assets, suppose you have a gold, furniture, machinery, you can touch, you can feel, they are called as tangible. Whereas goodwill, where you can't touch the goodwill, that is intangible asset. You can feel it, you cannot feel it, but the business, when you are, suppose for example, you are going to Saravana Bhavan Hotel, is there, Saravana Hotel, that name itself has got a value. And when suppose they have to sell the business, more than the assets they have, the name will carry a lot of money. So that is called as goodwill. Goodwill is nothing but an intangible asset which is for the future earning capacity of the company. Future's ability to earn super profits, the company, that only will be called the company is having the goodwill. A company which is likely to earn large profits over and above the normal expected profit, it will come on goodwill. That is called intangible asset. So the answer is, goodwill is an intangible asset. Right, next.
At the time of retirement, the profit on revaluation of assets and liabilities will be transferred to the dash side of capital accounts of all the partners.
So the answer is credit side. See friends, when there is a retirement or when there is an admission, new partner is coming, one of the three points will take place. One is, there will be alteration in the profit sharing ratios. Somebody is gaining and somebody is losing. Similarly, that's called sacrifice. In the case of admission, the existing partners are not supposed to share, sacrifice. In case of retirement, there will be gaining, because one man is going. So that is the first step. You always have to calculate the gaining ratio in case of retirement and sacrificing ratio in the case of admission. Second will be, you are going to revalue the assets and liabilities. Why you should revalue? Let me take an example. ABC start a business in 2000 and they purchase an asset for land for 5 lakhs. Now 2013, they want to, one of the partner want to retire. In the books, they would have shown only at 5 lakhs of rupees. But what is the true value? It can be 1 crore rupees. Therefore, the retiring partner would like it to be valued at 1 crore rupees. The market true values. Suppose if you have debtors where there are a lot of bad debts, you have to make adjustment for that. So therefore, whenever there is an admission or retirement of the partners, there will be revaluation of the assets and liabilities. So the net result is, suppose if the asset increases, it is a gain, profit. If the asset decreases, it is a loss. Similarly, liability decreases, it is a profit, and if the liability decreases, it's a gain. So the net gain will be credited to the partners in their old sharing ratios. So in other words, the profit on revaluation will be shown in the credit side of the partner's account. That is the credit side. That is, answer is credit side. Next.
Dash is considered as the official signature of the company.
That is called common seal, Raja Mudrai. Now, a company, we all know, is a creation of law. Just as me, just as you, company also in eyes of law is a person. That is an artificial judicial person. The difference between a natural person and a legal entity is that it cannot function. A person can sign. So therefore, the company, as you know, and the Solomon was a Solomon case, it is decided, has got a distinct personality. It can own assets, it can own liabilities. It is the company which will pay and it is the company which will receive. When you are dealing with company, you should know you are dealing with company and not with the directors. And therefore, how will the company deal with outsiders? It will have to deal by signing. How will it will sign? Through the common seal. Common seal is also called as Rajamundai. Right. Common seal is the answer. Next.
Forfeiture shares have to be reissued at a price dashed than the face value.
See, first of all, forfeiture means cancellation of shares. Forfeiture can take place when the shareholder is not paying the calls when they are made. Suppose that I have issued shares at 10 rupees and 3, 5, 2. 3 rupees on application, 5 rupees on allotment, 2 rupees on the final call. You have paid me 3 rupees and you have paid me 5 rupees, 8 rupees. But when I make the final call, you have refused to pay. Then, subject to the rules, articles of association, I can issue notice telling him that I will cancel it by giving a 14 days notice. And if he is not failing, I will cancel it. The amount paid by the shareholder will become a profit to me because I am not going to refund the money. So normally what I do, the shares, cancelled shares will be reissued to somebody at a discount less than that price. Normally, why a person will not pay? If a company is doing very well, he will borrow, steal and pay the money. And therefore, suppose market price of the share is 30 rupees, why the shareholder will not pay 2 rupees? By paying 2 rupees, he will get entire money back. And he thinks it is of no use for him. The company is already in losses. He will run away. So therefore, it's normally the shares, forfeited shares will be reissued at a discount. Less than is the answer. Next.
Return inwards are directed from.
See friends, sales is a goods go out. When some goods are not okay, they will return. So you will always take sales less sales returns. Purchases less purchase returns. So in other words, returns inwards will be deducted from sales. Sales less returns. Next.
All the items given in the adjustment will appear dashed in the final account.
See friends, when we come to single entry system of accounting, when you convert single entry to double entry, we know we need cash book and then adjustments. All items appearing in the cash book will be shown only once. For example, opening cash balance will go to opening balance sheet. Closing cash balance will go to closing balance sheet asset side. Whereas adjustments will be shown twice, double entry system. In cash book, already one entry is over, so only once. But when it comes to outside the trial balance, any item in the outside the trial balance will be shown twice. For example, salary is payable 10,000. You are not provided for it. So salaries is a debit balance. Salaries account data to salaries payable. So salaries will be shown in P&L account, salaries outstanding will be shown in the liability side. Similarly, interest receivable. So interest receivable account will be is an asset. So interest receivable account debtor to interest. Interest will be shown in P&L account as income. Interest receivable will be shown as asset side. So in other words, the rule is when an adjustments are given, anything coming outside the trial balance or outside the cash book, then it will be shown twice. That is the understanding. Next.
Under the net worth method, the basic for ascertaining the properties.
Net worth means, what is net worth? Assets minus liabilities. In other words, it is nothing but the share capital plus reserves minus losses. So net worth is the basis on which you will find out the capital. Understand? What is the question? Can you read again?
Under the net worth method, the basis for ascertaining the profit is.
That is the capital on two sides. Okay. So net worth means you will assets minus liabilities. So opening and closing, that difference will be profit. Next.
Credit sales is detailed from.
So credit sales will be not detailed, it will be found from the total debtors account. Total debtors account, what happens? What is the ledger account of total debtors? Two balance, two credit sales, two sales, that means credit entry will come by sales returns, by cash received, by bills receivable realized, received, bills receivable received, and bad debts if any, then closing balance. So in other words, we all know total debtors is the answer. Next.
Under diminishing balance method, depreciation. A. Decreases every year. B. Increase every year. C. Constant every year.
See friends, written down value method or reducing balance method. What is written down value? Cost minus depreciation. Take an example, I have got asset for 1 lakh. I am charging 10% depreciation. First year depreciation is 10,000. So written down value is 1 lakh minus 10,000, that is 90,000. Again I will charge 10%, 9,000. So in reducing balance method, your depreciation for the first year was 10,000, second year it is 9,000. So it will start diminishing. The answer is decreases every year. Whereas in a straight line method, it will be the same method. Depreciation charged is same. Next.
The term depletion is used for.
Depletion. Depletion of assets is method of depreciation is used for natural resources. What is depletion method? Suppose for example, I go on for a lease or I buy 100 acre plot which is expected to have a copper mine, it's a copper mine. Now it will not depreciate, I have to exploit. So suppose I estimate that the copper is, let us say, 1 lakh tons. So as long as I take that, if I take that every year 2000 tons, 3000, 4000 tons I am extracting, exploiting, then depreciation will be charged on the basis of how much tons I have exploited. If I don't exploit it, the copper is going to be there. So under depletion method is used for wasting assets, assets like coal, because only when you exploit them, the asset will become useless. Till then the asset will be there. So depletion method is used for natural resources like coal, copper, gold, etc. Next.
All profitability ratios are expressed in terms of.
Profitability ratio, let us take an example. Gross profit divided by sales into 100. GP ratio, gross profit ratio is a profitability ratio. Net profit ratio, cost ratio, all these things, gross profit 20,000, sales 1 lakh into 100, that means 20% of sales is gross profit. Therefore, the answer is in percentages. Next.
Which of the following option is correct? A. Tangible asset is equal to land plus building plus furniture. B. Tangible asset is equal to land plus building plus goodwill. C. Tangible asset is equal to land plus furniture plus goodwill plus copyrights.
Wherever copyrights and goodwill are intangible assets, friends. Goodwill you cannot touch. Copyrights, you got a right. For example, I write a book and their right on that, nobody can take it, nobody can copy that book. That right, I sing a song, then I get a right, royalties I can get for that. Where is right? Can I catch it? I cannot. So copyrights, goodwill, they are all intangible assets. Therefore, the answer is land, building and furniture, they are all tangible assets. Tangible means you can touch, feel. Right. Next.
Budget is expressed in terms of.
See, what is a budget? Budget is an action plan for future. Suppose that is always the action plans are driven by goals. For example, I want to sell 10,000 tires during this year. What do you mean by 10,000 tires? What will be the total revenue in rupees? So always budgets are quantified in monetary terms. The units, the action plans, the goals, everything has to be expressed in rupees. Finally, business means profit. So therefore, in monetary terms. What is the answer?
Money and fiscal unit.
So monetary terms, that is in terms of money and the units. Number of units I am going to sell, 10,000 tires. What is the total sales value? 10 crores, something like that. Next.
Interest on capital is calculated on the.
See, normally in a partnership, interest on capital is not allowed. If there is an agreement to that effect, that partners agree that we should get interest, then it will interest be allowed. Now, again they can agree that partners will be, how to calculate the interest, because there may be money they will be introduced, they will take away, things like that. Yeah, everything is agreement. But in the absence of agreement, interest is calculated on opening capital. Opening capital. Next.
When A and B sharing profits and losses in the ratio of 3:2, they admit C as a partner, giving him 1/3 share of profit. This will be given by A and B.
See, friends, A and B are sharing in the ratio of 3:2. In other words, 3:2 is called 60%, 40%. Suppose B is admitted for what share? B is admitted
for 1/3 share of profit.
1/3 share B is taking away. A and B, C. C is coming, no?
Yes.
C is taking away 1/3 share. So what is the cake left behind them? 2/3. So these 2/3, these people will have to share it in the ratio of 60:40. In other words, these 60:40 is the basis on which both of them will sacrifice. In all these methods, the old ratio will be the sacrificing ratio, I suppose. Next.
On admission of a partner, if goodwill account is to be raised, this should be devoted to.
See, goodwill you are going to create. Before the partner comes in, you want to create, because it's an asset which is recognized. Of course, that will be agreed between the incoming partner and the old partners, a negotiation. Suppose if they agree that the goodwill of the firm is lay 1 lakh, but in the balance sheet it is not there, so you have to create an asset. So what you will do? Goodwill account et al., that is the asset is created. When the asset is created, that is a profit to the old partners. So it will be shared in the old ratios. So goodwill account et al. To A and B. Right, next.
According to Table A, interest charged on calls in advance is
6%. You can check up. For example, the call. Suppose the shares are issued, 10 rupee share, 3 on application, 5 on allotment and 2 on final call. When to make the call is the prerogative of the directors, because whenever the company needs money, they will make a call. But when the call is made, it is the duty of the shareholder to pay that money. As you know, in a limited liability, Companies Act is based on limited liability concept. That means that shareholder who has, suppose I take 1000 shares in X Limited, I paid 3 rupees and 5 rupees, 8000 I paid. My liability is only 2000 rupees, that's all. If the company goes into big losses, I am not responsible other than paying 2000 rupees. That is called as unlimited liability. A limited liability. For example, the directors have made the call and then they will tell you within this date you must give the money. Suppose I am not paying the money and if there is a provision in the articles of association, then they can charge 6% interest in calls in arrears. Next.
Calls in advance.
Where the shareholder pays the money in advance. For example, I have asked you to pay 3 rupees only on application, 5 rupees on allotment. Suppose the shareholder pays 8 rupees. That means that 5 rupees becomes in advance. But that will be paid only when there is a provision. Interest will be paid only when there is a provision in the article. So that will not exceed 6%. Next.
When a company issues shares at a price more than the face value, it is called on issue at?
See, the share can be issued at a 10 rupee share. I can issue at 10 rupees. That is called issued at face value or issued at par. Suppose I am issuing 10 rupee share at 12 rupees. That is called as premium. See, when will you issue at 10 rupees share at 12 rupees? When the company is doing very well, already there are a lot of reserves, huge profits they are making, then the share will go at a premium. You can see a share of a Tata Steel, 10 rupee face value share is going at 400 rupees. Therefore, that is because of the accumulated reserves, etc. So therefore, if you are issuing at a price above the face value, it's called as premium. And if it is issued at less than the face value, it's called as discount. Next.
Capital reserve is shown on the dash side of balance sheet.
Capital reserve. Reserves are all shown in the liability side. Whether it is a capital reserve, general reserve, P&L account, share pre security premium, all these things are reserves which will be shown in the liability side of the balance sheet. Okay. So this completes 2013 June 2013 exam. My friends, the object of this lecture is to give you reasons and broader view about the answers instead of just reading out the answers. So why we have to take it into consideration also, I have given reasons. So friends, we are going to March 2013. Wherever the repeat questions have come, lot of questions are repeated, which we have already explained in the June 2013. Therefore, whatever is not explained only, I am going to explain you, otherwise it will become repetition. So I repeat, March 2013, the 30 questions are there, out of which we are going to take less than 30. That is because all questions are repetitive, for which I have already given explanations. So let's move on. Can you read first question?
Debts which are not recoverable from sundry debtors are termed as?
So a debt means something which you can recover, actionable claim. So if you are not able to recover, asset is an asset. Not able to recover means it's a loss. That's called as bad debts. Bad debt is a loss, expense. That will be shown in the debit side of the P&L account as expense. Bad debts are from debtor to sundry debtors is the journal entry. Next.
statement of affairs method is also called as dash
net worth statement of affairs. In case of a single entry system of accounting, since the trader does not keep the books on a scientific method of double entry system, what you do is a total assets as on that date and total liabilities you will take. That is called statement of affairs. Assets minus liabilities will be called as net worth or capital. So it is called as net worth method. Next.
Dash method of depreciation is suitable for special type of asset like loose tools.
See, what is a loose tool? Spanners. When you are having a factory, they will have jigs, tools and things like that. Sundry items. So how will you value them? So what they do is, the loose tools, I would have purchased them, let's say at let's say 50,000 rupees. So at the end of the year, I would like to value them. And what will be the value if I sell them, realizable value. So the revaluation method will be a better method. Right. You will not do a depreciation saying 10% or 15% like that. So one of the methods we can use is revaluation method. Some companies may follow 50,000 rupees means, okay, the loose tool's life is 2 years, you write off 50% like that, they can also come. So normally revaluation method is used. Next.
Liquid ratio is otherwise known as?
Liquid ratio is also known as quick ratio. See friends, the balance sheet, you have two types of assets. One is called as a long term, furniture, machinery, land and buildings. They are long term assets kept in the business for more than 1 year. That is one. And the purpose of keeping is to produce goods, because you don't keep fixed assets for sale. Fixed assets are meant for use to produce goods which are sold. That is called the nature of fixed assets. So the fixed assets analysis will be called solvency. How is these fixed assets are used? That will be turnover ratio. How the fixed assets are financed? That point we will discuss. Coming to this second part is current assets. The current assets are those assets which are kept in a business for a period of less than 1 year. Stock, raw materials you purchase. Why you purchase raw material? You have to convert it into finished goods. So I buy leather. The purpose is to convert it into shoes. Leather is a raw material. Shoe is a finished goods. In between is called work in progress. Then the finished shoes I sell. I'll sell it on credit. I get debtors. And then I keep some cash balance. So always there will be some current assets. Stock, debtors, and then cash. Now, what is the meaning of current assets? Normally I buy leather on credit. I pay wages after 1 month. I produce goods. I sell the goods. And from that money realized again, I pay the creditors. That is how business goes on. So at any given time, I would like to see whether the company has got sufficient money to run the day-to-day operations. That is called liquidity. Whether the company is having liquid money. So you may have a lot of assets, but when you go in a bus, you don't have change, then they will ask you to get down. So that is called liquid ratio. And if you see the liquidity, the current assets by current liabilities, that is called current ratio. But in current assets, there is a difference between a stock and a debtors and cash. So debtors and cash are near to cash, whereas inventories, only when you sell, you will get the right to receive money. The money may, if suppose goods are not sellable, then you will have problem. Therefore, there is another way you analyze it. One ratio is current assets by current liabilities. Another ratio is quick ratio. That is current assets minus inventories by current liabilities. Current assets minus inventories are called as liquid assets. That's called quick ratio is the answer. Next.
the excess of average profit over normal profit is?
See friends, the goodwill is basically for super profits. You understand? So Rajinikanth is there, he's a superstar. He is able to command something higher than anybody else can command. So super profits are the profits earned by a partnership firm or a company over and above the expected profits. For example, you have a Hindu paper is there. Early morning everybody will read that paper. So therefore, they are already, that name itself has got assured customers. Suppose I start a new paper, nobody will know about it. So therefore, that name assures you, and that is going to get you enhanced customers, assured customers. So always, super profit is the actual average profits divided by normal profits. For example, a business, normal return in a business is say 10%. So I invest 20 lakhs, I will get 2 lakhs normal business. But this business is getting 3 lakhs. That means that 1 lakh, that is called a super profit. And for that, that will be the basis for valuation of goodwill. Maybe 3 years purchase of super profits like that. Next.
Undistributed profit will appear on the dash side of the balance sheet.
So all profits will come in the liability side. That we know. Next. The answer is liability side.
If the value of liabilities decreases, it results in dash.
See, liabilities decrease. Actual question to be understood like this. Suppose, for example, I have got sundry creditors. Suppose I got loan. When will the loan decrease? When I repay it. When will the sundry creditors will decrease? When I pay them. Understand? So, the cash will go out. That is one reason. Another reason is, you don't want to pay. Say for example, you have created a provision for repairs, liability for repairs 10,000, but actual repairs come to only 7,000, so that 3,000 will become a profit for you. So it should be understood what question is this. In this case, if liability decreases, what is the reason? It could be the decrease can be because you pay them to. Decrease can be because there is no longer there is a liability. So when there is no longer there is a liability, that will be a profit for you. Because already you have charged 10,000 rupees as a repairs, provision for repairs account account to provision for repairs. But now you think there is no need for that provision. So you remove it. So your profit will increase. Therefore that will be increasing profits. Next.
The liability of shareholders are dashed in a company.
In a limited company, as already explained, the liability of a shareholder is limited to the amount unpaid by him. It is a limited liability. What is a limited liability? As already explained by me, suppose if a shareholder takes 1000 rupees, 1000 shares of 10 each, and he pays 8 rupees, his liability is only 2000 rupees. If the company incurs 1 crore loss also, this man's liability will be limited to only 2,000. That is limited liability concept. Next.
Interest on drawings is deducted from?
Interest on drawings is deducted from the capital. Next. That's all.
Credit sales is obtained from?
That already answered. Next.
Depreciation arises due to?
See, depreciation, definition of depreciation is diminishing in the value of the asset. Why the asset value depreciates? Normally, the asset value depreciates because of wear and tear, usage. 2, passage of time, efflux of time. 3, destruction of the asset. Suppose an accident has taken place, the asset productivity falls. Or obsolescence. Suppose, for example, I am producing tape recorders. I have got very good machines to produce them, but today nobody wants tape recorders. They want other systems have come. So, therefore, it becomes obsolete, outdated. So, all these are going to affect this thing. Depreciation arises because of this. In this problem, they have given, what are the items they have given questions? A. Wear and tear is the answer.
Wear and tear of this.
Wear and tear is usage. But normally, the definition of depreciation is the diminution of the value of the asset used for a business. Which are the assets used for business? Building assets which will depreciate are only buildings, plant and machinery and furniture. Land will not depreciate. And depreciation is on account of not only wear and tear, efflux of time. The asset you buy, after 1 year it becomes second-hand asset. Nobody, suppose I buy a computer and now I want to sell, they will not buy for the same value. Right. Over.
All activity ratios are expressed in terms of.
See friends, let me explain you this repeatedly asked question. What are all the ratios? Ratios can be grouped. One, analysis of final profit and loss account. So how this company has performed? What are the sales? What is the gross profit? What is the net profit? What are the expenses? So as we saw, these profitability ratios, performance ratios are basically expressed as a percentage. Gross profit ratio 20%, net profit ratio 10%, like that. The next point is balance sheet. In the balance sheet, you have two positions are there. Long-term position, equity share capital, reserves, preference share capital, debentures. They are all long-term funds. And fixed assets are long-term applications. When you are going to analyze these two long-term positions, it's called solvency. I'll give a simple example. For example, I have taken fixed deposit of 1 crore and then I purchased the buildings. Short-term funds I have applied in long-term applications. Suppose if all the people who gave money ask me, give me now, where can I go and give money? Can I sell the fixed assets? Not possible. So therefore, the company will collapse. So the rule of finance is long-term assets should always be funded out of long-term obligations. That is where you test the solvency. It could be return on investment when the company is able to earn money and earnings per share. So many things are there. Then short-term position analysis, as I explained already, current position, liquidity, whether the company has got money to meet the day-to-day operations. That is balance sheet. Now what are the items in balance sheet? Fixed assets. Why do you keep fixed asset? Is to produce goods. That means sales. Similarly, why the debtors come? Because of credit sales. Why the creditors come? Because of credit purchases. So there is a connection between these two. Therefore, this is turnover is calculated times. Understand, cost of goods sold 20 lakhs, fixed assets 10 lakhs. So, fixed assets turnover ratio is in number of times. So here, activity is implied as a turnover ratio. Therefore, it is given in terms of number of time.
Next, the public issue must be kept open for at least
3 days. Minimum 3 days you have to keep it open. Yes.
At the time of retirement of a partner,
the
difference between new profit ratio and old profit ratio is dash ratio.
Retirement, as already explained, one fellow is going. If there are three persons are there, one person is there, gone. Two persons will gain. So retirement is gaining ratio, admission is sacrificing ratio.
The maximum calls that a company can make is?
Three. The maximum calls that a company can make is application, allotment and first and final call.